not so. Actually, we are super excited to share with you what our keynote this morning. And the reason that I'm really happy to be up here is because this is not about me at all. In fact, you're going to hear an entire list of voices that are not mine, a chorus of voices from our students and from your colleagues. For those of you here in the back, there's plenty of seats down front, so feel free to slide on up. So with that said, we're going to get started into this journey of Waukesha One and what it means to amplify student voice. But before we do, I just want to say something really impressive. So about 5 years ago, 2015, somebody asked the question, how can we give a conference-like experience to everybody in the district? At the time, we were sending just small groups off to conferences. And Waukesha One and the One Conference is our answer to that question. So we're in our fifth year. Our fifth year is bringing an entirely new set of experiences to the conference. It's here for you to enjoy. I'll tell you that the first thing that you should know, though, is that everything you see today is brought to you by a really small planning committee. So you'll see their names scrolling. Maybe you saw them scrolling up here this morning and see them scrolling on the signage throughout the day. If you see a Waukesha One committee planning member, thank them if you enjoyed your day, if you learned something. The other group that I really want to say thank you to are those of you who have agreed to step forward and present. So this day doesn't happen without your knowledge and your expertise, your big ideas, and your willingness to share those things. And so the One Conference happens, and the learning that takes place happens because of your willingness and generosity to put work into that and share with your colleagues. All of the big ideas you hear today came from people who've actually practiced it with their classrooms. And to us, that's the most important part of today. So thank you to all of you who are presenting, and if you are learning from someone today, just pass the kindness on to say thank you to them as well. That's incredibly important. So, a couple of great moments from the last couple of One conferences. Hopefully we'll have some more of those today. If you are on Twitter, or if you're not on Twitter and you want to join us, SDW1 is the hashtag. Just check it out and see what you can find, and you'll get all sorts of interesting moments from the One conference. Things that you didn't see. Most of these are a surprise to me. By the way, when I get home at night, I'm like, that happened today? So, great place to check it out. Also, just a really quick thank you to sponsors. So the list of people that you see here today came from far and wide. We have people who've traveled a long distance to be here today with us. One of our key pieces is making sure that our vendors, people that we already purchased from, can join us and be a part of the day. This is not a sales pitch. This is about learning from experts who know these products inside and out and can answer questions. So this group of people, really important group of business partners, we want to make sure we thank them. Also, they're the folks who help bring things like Continental Breakfast and the popcorn bar later today. So if you see a vendor today or working with them in a session, feel free to extend your thanks to them as well. So let's get on to the theme for this year, amplifying student voice. So you can tell I'm a child of the 80s by my warm Care Bear snuggies, right? A lot of us have really great moments where we think about what it was like to be a kid. Most of us have those feelings of like that nostalgia of being a kid. I do too. I had great parents, great upbringing, great hometown, great brother, really a wonderful life. But there's one certain reality that happens when we think about childhood. We forget this part. Now that I'm a parent, I remember it. The things that we say to our kids, inadvertently, in the moment, that send messages about what their social status is, right? The adults have to talk right now, honey. Just give us a few moments, okay? Or we turn up the car radio and we are talking softly under the car radio about something that we need to talk about because the kids might hear it in back. The reality is our kids have an incredible voice and they have a lot to say. And so when my daughter said to me on Saturday, Dad, could you turn the car radio down so that I can hear what you're saying up there, right? They have an interest. They want to know what's going on. They have a voice too in what's happening in that conversation. So when we were planning today, the instructional tech coordinator team, Wendy Liska, Kristen Bruchot, and myself were planning and talking about this conversation. Kristen brought this video to the forefront. This video is from Apple. It came out in November. You may have missed it. I did. But it is an incredibly important part when we start to talk about the importance of student voice and all of our voices. So let's watch the video.
Wake up and smell the coffee. Is your cup half full or empty? When we talk, you say it softly. But I love it when you're awfully quiet.
So when we look at that and we think about the importance of voice, I think there's a couple of key moments that we really have to pay attention to from that video. The first is this picture, right? The things that we have to say, the things that our students have to say, the thoughts and ideas that they're having for the first time, their big ideas that get locked away because they're not good enough for the world to hear yet. I'm not confident enough that we can share those with people. Or this one. We've all had this, by the way. That moment when something leaves our control, something that has been tucked in that box, suddenly slips away from us. How many of our students, when we ask them to share, have that feeling? I'm handing it over to you, but this is the look I'm having. And then the last one. You probably have seen this from students who come up to you and ask you about a paper you have yet to grade. That was me as an English teacher, right? How'd I do, right? The question of, is it good enough? Because I know your critique is going to be telling me what I fear the most, that it's going to be awful, that it's not going to live up to your expectations. But not everybody has that feeling. And not everyone has to have that feeling all of the time. I'm going to share with you a video from somebody who didn't have that feeling. Let's take a look.
Just be nice and be responsible, and just don't give up.
So I got the last couple of months have been me filling with moments of that kind of thing, as we've been asking kids to submit their stories. So, Marisa, right, Bethesda student, I just love that look, right? My mom walks to the frame and goes, oh, what's happening here? It doesn't matter, right? I've got something to say. And then we look at this, and we put them side by side. Our goal in amplifying student voice isn't just about pushing the send button. It's not just about the publish. It's about moving students from that left picture over the confidence of that right picture. That's our job. That's what we can do. So, we asked about, early November, we asked, an email came out from Jody Landish saying, hey students, tell us your story. And we didn't give them much more than that, right? Tell us a little bit about yourself. You have something to share? Share with us. And they just wrote. Christina, the story that we're gonna hear from next, Christina wrote about 3 pages single-spaced just because she needed to get it out and say something, right? A lot of students did. They had things to say. She was also the first person we put the second hurdle in place where we said, oh, by the way, you have to create a video for people to see. She was the first person to submit that as well. So let's take a look at Christina's story.
My story by Christina. I was born in Montana on March 17th, 2004. Then my mom, my sister, and I moved back to Wisconsin when my sister was born in 2002. My stepdad passed away when I was in second grade. My biological father and my mother got divorced when I was one, which is why we moved back here. When I'm older, I want to live in the country with pigs and cows. I also want to have one child adopted, a little girl named Fern. I also want a pet teacup pig named Wilbur, both from Charlotte's Web. In third through fifth grade, I was bullied, and I was too scared to do anything about it. I want to share my story because I want other people to be able to do something about it. I'm sharing my story by expressing myself and what has made me who I am today. I will also share my story in my very own book one day. Without technology, I wouldn't have been able to write nearly as much as I am this day. Technology has helped me improve my writing in so many ways, I don't know where my writing would be without technology. There you go. That's my story, or at least a short and less complicated version of it. My story's not over yet, and neither is yours, so we both have time to make them great. I hope you've heard my voice. My story.
We also have other stories, right? All sorts of stories. So these are two students who are really working to change the world in some pretty incredible ways, and they're doing it without a lot of motivation from us here at school, right? They're doing it because it matters to them. So let's hear about changing the world.
Hello, my name is Bridget, and to make my voice heard, I've gone to several protests to show my political belief. I think that's important for young people to watch the news so that they know what's going on in the world, but to especially pay close attention to the politics part, because politics is really our world, and when you grow up, you want to know as much as you can about it. Young people often look over politics because it seems more of an adult issue, when really this is our world too, and it's our problem too. I use technology while going to protests by making my sign from quotes on my iPad. And my parents also helped me by making sure that I could go to the protest and drive me there.
My name is Madison, and I'm in 9th grade at Washington High School. Here's a picture of me dancing. I have been dancing for 12 years. One of my goals as a child was to go on point. Just last year, I achieved that goal and decided to set a new goal. My new goal was to start a dance group at my church and teach kids how to dance. Dance had become my second language, and I wanted to give kids that gift as well, because sometimes dancing is a little bit easier than talking about your emotions. I've established a dance group and called it Spirit Dancing. At my high school, I am involved in the marching band, and we have many hard practices. Perseverance has definitely brought me through those practices and keeps me going because I can't let the team down. Marching band has definitely taught me the quality of perseverance, and I brought that quality to my group because I can't let the kids down. Technology has also helped a lot in my group because obviously it helps spread the message that I'm starting a group, but it's also helped me by recording our dances, the children can show their family what they've worked on. And it also helps us remember what we did last time. So thank you very much, and this is how I'm sharing my voice in the world.
In both stories, we have students sharing their voice. Specifically, though, in the second story, I asked her, okay, so just wondering, who got you excited about that? How'd you get that idea going? She said, I just wanted to share, it's been important for me. But what I love about that video is, it's the lessons that we're teaching in our classrooms, it's the lessons that she's getting from us,
as well as her family and her community, that she's starting to interface into the world. So we're having an impact in lots of ways. We are the gatekeepers of our classrooms. We get to decide if we're going to create the conditions that are going to make deep learning possible for students. That's our choice. We work with students, we have that opportunity. Whether you have them face-to-face in class every day, or you work with them sporadically, or you work through their teachers, those are opportunities for us to create conditions for deep learning. So, this is not my question, but I'm going to ask you to think about something. I want you to think about the students that you've worked with to this point this year, just this year. How many of them, on some level, maybe not to this extreme, on some level are disconnected? How many of them, on some level, aren't giving us their best? We don't even know their story. So we were asked this question in fall when Patrick Briggs was here. He asked the question, what is your acceptable level of casualty? Who are the kids that you're going to allow get away with not telling their story, not being a part of our world, not engaging, right? So I want you to think about that. If you have a couple of faces in mind, you have to wrestle with this question. The year's not gone. It's not over. We have an opportunity yet. But it's about hearing every one of their stories and every one of their voices. So now we're going to shift a little bit and focus on what are some ways that technology is impacting the ability for students to really amplify their voice. So here you're going to hear from two students, one who's working outside of the classroom and one who's working very hard inside of the classroom, where they're using humor and video to be heard.
Ms. Deborah, and I'm a sophomore at the Waukesha Engineering Preparatory Academy. In true teenage fashion, I've decided to work on this video the night before it is due. A little while ago, my friend created a YouTube account, and I decided to butt my way into it. I'm not going to share any of the videos or the channel name, but I swear the videos exist. We decided to create this channel because we wanted to make dumb videos, just like all the other dumb videos that we watch all the time. When I make my videos, I record them using my camera or my phone, and today I'm using my computer. I usually have to take the SD card from my camera or my phone and transfer it to my Mac. Then I use iMovie to edit those videos and then upload them to YouTube. Without technology, I wouldn't have a creative outlet to express my talents and possibly show them to future employers. Also, you wouldn't be watching this video right now.
Hello, Roboppers. My name is Gavin, and I am here to give you your weather forecast. I put myself in the newsroom by using the green screen. As I was coming, taught me how I practiced my lunch and my jokes of course. I shared it with reality Chris Nelson to get the feedback. He really liked my joke. He told me that maybe he should include some jokes in his weather forecast. I told him that it may make it more interesting to watch. I shared the weather forecast with my class and then wanted to learn how to use a green screen, so I taught them how and gave them advice with the jokes too. They really have to have a few jokes in your forecast. Time for a joke. How does the rain tie its shoes with the rainbow? That's funny.
No joke. I sent him back, as we were communicating, I sent him back a weather joke I thought he'd use, and I didn't get a response. So I don't think mine worked either. And Deborah, I asked her, how many hits are we getting on a video? Those popular ones are hitting about 800, 850 views that they're getting. So they're being viewed, right? Now we have some students who are talking about how they connect around the globe or connect back into Waukesha from around the globe. Opportunities that didn't necessarily exist when we went to school.
And I'm Lauren. Lauren and I have made postcards on our iPads that are sent around the world as a part of Global Read Aloud.
Global Read Aloud is when you and other classes from around the world connect about one book that you're in the process of reading or has already read.
The book that our class is connected on was called Refugee. This book is written by Alan Gross.
We have also included a slideshow on our iPads all about language workshop, reading workshop, and writing workshop in Miss Wayne's classroom.
As another part of Global Read Aloud, we have sent and received postcards from around the world, both digitally on our iPads and on paper. And here are some of the postcards we have received from around the world.
I'm Sydney.
And I'm Frederick.
And our family travels around the world to make movies. The reason we make movies is because we want to make the world a better place. We need to get the message out there. We made a movie called A Billion Lives, and it's about how the government is keeping people smoking by banning the smoking alternatives.
We got a lot of awards and trophies. In some places, people were difficult and we didn't have Wi-Fi, and it was really hard to go around. And when we went to India, we were coughing a lot and a lot of us got really sick. All the struggles, we got the movie done and we still do travel.
We couldn't have done it without technology. We needed the cameras, we needed transportation, we need the computers for editing, and we need movie screens, of course, to show it.
We also emailed family back at home.
We made a lot of friends around the world, too.
We're gonna keep traveling around the world to get the message out and make movies.
Pretty impressive stories. And then we have students who are becoming the voices of the media. These students, I just want to note, aren't students who are being prompted necessarily by a grade. They aren't necessarily being put to do this by a class project. And we've heard a lot of stories about high school students not necessarily just doing things that they might, you know, without being told they have to or being forced to or without getting a grade. Here's some students who are doing exactly that.
Hi, I'm Mehul.
And I'm Mohammed. And we co-founded the Blackshirt newspaper at Waukesha South High School.
The Blackshirt newspaper is a student-run online news publication that provides a platform for South students to voice their opinions and become better informed Blackshirts.
We publish a variety of content, from news, editorials, and interviews, in the interest of South students.
The newspaper has been tremendously successful since its inception in January 2018, garnering over 60,000 views from 49 states.
Being an online newspaper, technology has been instrumental to our success.
Our team strives to use various media platforms to express our content.
In addition, there was programming involved in the creation of our website. The Waukesha One Conference is a tremendous opportunity to showcase the power of amplification of student voices. So make sure to check out theblackshirt.org.
Hey Waukesha One, I'm Jameson True and I'm a senior at Waukesha South High School.
And I'm Julia and we're the executive producers of the Blackshirt Briefing. The Blackshirt Briefing is an informative newscast that brings information to the students of the school. We ask students for their opinions on segments for the week to come, and we also say what's happening in and out of school for the week.
Good morning, Blackshirts! Welcome to this week's Blackshirt Briefing. Today is Monday, December 10th. I'm Tanner.
And I'm Nicole. Students, do you have things on your mind you want to talk about? Contact Peers for Peers to talk about anything that might be bothering you. To find someone to talk to, head to the guidance office and ask a counselor for more information.
Hey, all you Blackshirt super fans! This week, Friday, we have an away game at Carroll against CMH. Theme is PJ Party, so wear your onesies and bring a robe. See you there! Go, Blackshirts!
And here in the Blackshirt Briefing, we definitely use all the technology to our advantage. We have the cameras to film everything. We have the computers and iPads just to edit and write scripts on. So we definitely collaboratively use all the technology we have to make sure that our product that we produce is great. We'd also love to give a great thank you to Ms. Peterson, Ms. Nordstrom for making this happen. We could definitely not do this without you, and we just want to say thank you.
So if anybody knows anybody in Alaska, Mohammed and Mehul seem to really have the hang up that they haven't gotten Alaska's vote yet. So if you can just let me know, we'll get them hooked up, then they'll have all 50 states, we'll be in good shape. I just love that focus in on it. So technology as a springboard for careers. So these are wonderful experiences for our students to have, and getting their voice out there is so important. But we know that we're getting them ready for something more than that. Here's some students who have found ways to utilize the technology available to them to really start to springboard into their careers.
My name is Melody. I share my voice through my artwork, specifically the various concept art I've gotten to work on for the past 9 months. I was lucky to get this opportunity and would like to pursue a job like this in the future.
Technology has helped me with this work in a big way. Because the person I've been working with on this project lives on the other side of the world, so I never would have met them otherwise. I'm very proud of everything I've contributed to the game he's developing, and I hope when it's all done, I'll be able to play it myself. It's also been very interesting seeing the process come together from start to finish.
Hi, my name is Lauren, and I'm a senior at West High School.
Anyone who knows me knows that I love politics. I love everything about it. I love debates, I love campaigns, I love grassroots movements, I love activism. And I just think it's really important for young people to get involved early.
I realized that if young people wanted our voices respected when our government looks like this, I had to do something. So I did. I started a countywide organization that is centered around getting youth politically active and engaged, which has been aided by social media, particularly Instagram.
Over the course of the year that has followed, that has shown amazing results. In solidarity with the survivors of the Parkland shooting last January, a friend and I planned and led a school-wide walkout in March, along with thousands of others who participated nationwide. Last spring, I held a voter registration drive along with Interact Club at West during all of the lunches so that graduating seniors were registered to vote before leaving for college. And then I organized a second one this fall. And in the city of Waukesha this past November, there was a record high turnout of voters, which was due in large part to the youth that took time to early vote or took advantage of their e-achieve or release periods to get out and vote on November 6th. I adore politics. I love government. I think that it is really important to get youth involved early and to encourage activism and to encourage becoming more informed and reading the news and watching the news. And just in general, getting youth voices heard and respected and listened to. It gives me a lot of hope for what this future can be if these students are being so active now and are being so receptive to this activism now. And I am very much looking forward to what myself and my peers will get done in the next 40 years or so, and how the country will look by then, and just to be able to look back and see all that we've done to bring it to.
Me too. So, I think you can sense the power, and there were many more students who wrote many written submissions. We just shared with you the video submissions that we received. Now, students self-submitted. And I think for out of fairness to the teachers that you see up here today, who you're going to start hearing from next, you should know that they were nominated. They were not people who self-submitted this. But I'll tell you that they have shared incredible stories. I feel so fortunate to have spent as much time with them, even though I wasn't even there on filming day, right, as they'll tell you. The amount of time I've spent editing down these videos and listening and learning from this crew of people is incredible. For the sake of time, you're going to get snippets of their videos tied together today. But at the end of the day today, you're going to get the full versions of each of their stories. And I cannot say enough to you how important it would be and how valuable it would be for you to just spend some time learning from these teachers. So thank you to these teachers for sharing. And we're going to hear some stories now. The first is the reality that we have some students who physically just don't have that voice, right? Or who have learned not to share a voice because of struggles that they face. So here are two teachers who are working with students who fit that category, but are making sure that voices are heard.
Kathy Miller, an advisor at Waukesha Transition Academy Sales Services. We work with young adults that are at the end of their school career, getting ready to head into the adult world. Many times our young adults are adept at fading into the background, filled with anxiety about being laughed at or making a mistake or doing the wrong thing. They know that they struggle where others do not.
Writing student voice really matters because it gives our students, especially those who aren't able to yet vocally, verbally communicate, the ability to share their knowledge. And we'd like them to eventually be able to move into carrying on conversations and participating in classroom discussions and sharing their knowledge, because there's so much in there that we're not able to bring out before that we can show them that they're able to bring out.
The iPad would be the key that opened the door to the world of learning for young adults, an equalizer. Young adults and I, for the first time, were learning together, the same content, collaborating.
Is that it really promotes independence, and it eliminates part of the need for relying on other people and empowering the student themselves to be able to learn at a different pace, but yet in their own way. So one of the big things that the district has provided that a lot of districts haven't provided to students to provide assistive technology to students in the form of speech output applications on their iPads. And this has really helped kind of change the way that we give instruction to students by allowing them to have a way to choose their answers and to show them to us in a completely different way. And so students that we thought we didn't know exactly how we were going to find out what they were thinking or how they were feeling or what they were getting from their educational experience, we're able to now gradually coach them into using these devices.
The first young adult to jump in with both feet was unable to read print and struggled to write more than his name. Asked what would you like to learn, his response was swift and sure, to build a website about the dangers of texting while driving, walking, and riding a bike. The impact of what we were doing became crystal clear on the day young adults met with Steve Schloman, Brian Yearling, and Dale Van Curen. I was not with them at the table, confidently showing what they were creating and answering questions. After the gentleman left, the three young adults were very emotional and in tears. They saw me, not my disability, me, was the statement that tore at my heart. At that moment, young adult voice went from an interest and became a passion.
I think the most important thing is to always presume competence, and that is that as educators, we share the belief that all students have the ability to learn, and they just might show it in a different way or need access to a different tool that we haven't yet found in our toolbox. Giving students the choice of when and how to complete tasks that are assigned to them, that are at their level. It's important to have high expectations and to build a classroom community around the student of helping in a way that doesn't overhelp or overservice a student, but to help them be more independent.
Young adults that may have been content to hide in the background are now vibrant learners, practicing skills that they need to succeed in any environment they're in as adults. I would end this with a young adult's reflection during his last week with us. Thank you for believing in me until I could believe in myself.
Whether your students fit into the same category that they're talking about with students who don't have that physical voice or have this unique challenges, every one of our students has a challenge. Every one of our students also has the tools and the support around them to make them independent. I can tell you, I remember well the day that we went in to meet with that group of students, and I can speak for the three of us. We saw three very confident young men who shared with us an incredible project that they had put work into. We had no backstory about where they had come from or what challenges they had overcome. All we heard was an incredible story, and we saw an incredible product as they were collecting data, building a website, and putting their voice out into the world. So now we're going to hear from some other folks who are going to share with us why they bother. Why bother using the technology? Why bother finding ways to incorporate student voice into their classrooms?
So incorporating student voice is something that is critical. It's actually life-changing and world-changing. If we think about each human, every single one of us is different, whether they're the people that we spend our time with during the day, whether they're our family, whether they're people that we don't know. Every single person is unique. And the moment that we take away the opportunity for any one human to not have their voice heard, we are impacting the world, we are impacting our community, and we're impacting our classrooms, and we're impacting that particular student.
I also think student voice matters because it's a culturally relevant practice. It enables students to have a chance to talk about what matters to them and enables them to express their personal beliefs, their personal habits, their family traditions, and all of that really makes for a more culturally relevant classroom.
Incorporating student voice to me is so important because we have such a diverse group of students here in Waukesha. With that diverse group comes so many different perspectives, stories, cultures, and voices sitting in front of us. These perspectives have brought issues and topics into my classroom that I otherwise might not have covered. As my co-teacher says, they want to be heard and they want to know that their voice matters.
In the early primary, it's not always easy to get our students to pick up a pencil and express all their thinking on paper. They often have so much to say, but are limited by the mastery of phonics and often their fine motor skills. But their voice is so much deeper than what they are able to put onto a piece of paper.
This is where technology has totally been a game changer in our classroom. Through technology, our students are able to voice their interests, challenge prior knowledge, go deeper into their thinking, accept both positive and constructive feedback, and connect globally with other students.
Student voice is incredibly important to us because we need to know where students are coming from, what they're thinking, where their interests lie, where their confusion is. And if they don't tell us that, we don't always know. Especially at the high school level, where we have such a fragmented day, we need to capture that moment of confusion, that moment of interest, and really incite some conversation.
I incorporate student voice into my classroom because it allows students to bring their own knowledge and experience into my room. Rather than just getting information, they become creators of information and creators of music. I also incorporate student voice because students get excited to share. And what more could I ask for? Kids who are excited to learn and make music.
Because they matter. They have so much inside of them. They're thinking about so many things. They're wondering about the world. They're figuring things out. They're exploring new ways to communicate, new ways to understand. And so much of that is lost in spaces where we have kids listen more than they speak.
So if we're going to create those spaces where they are speaking more than they're listening, where they're creating more than they're consuming, then we have to ask the next question. What are some ways that we can do that? So we ask them, can you give us some ideas? What are you doing in your classroom? Things that we can take away as a group and possibly start infusing or at least brainstorming from. So let's take a listen to this.
The Global Read Aloud is a program that we have worked through in my classroom for the last 2 years. What it is a connection of classrooms around the world reading a common book, common text. And through that experience, we have developed relationships via postcards, via Skype.
As a first grade teacher in math, is the kids can record their voice explaining their thinking. Because in the beginning, they don't yet have the strategies to be able to write their thinking or their strategies. They know what they did, but they don't know how to represent that either with words or symbols. So they can tell the iPad how they solved the problem, and then later I can listen to their thinking, and then I know what strategies they're using, and it helps me then to guide them.
Some technology that I've used to allow student voice to happen is VoiceThread. What's nice about that is it's an app where students record themselves speaking to prompts that I've given ahead of time, questions that I've posed. What's really great about that is all students respond, not just a few. If I asked a question in class, kids will raise their hand, or I'll cold call on someone, and we get to hear from that child, and maybe a couple more. But with technology, everybody gets a chance to respond. Everyone's expected to respond as well.
Recently, I just tried a new app called Seesaw. I'm noticing that they're using this app to basically reteach what they learned. At the end of the class, I give them about 10 minutes to reflect on their learning for that class. Every day, they use this app called Seesaw to reflect on their learning, and they can draw, they can record themselves, they can write out what they're thinking. And all those options really allow students to do what works for them.
Each week we use the green screen along with Do Ink and have them create our classroom weekly news report. They write the scripts, interview students and staff, create the background, edit, and produce the newscast. They decide what is important each week, not us.
I think in the high school we struggle sometimes with getting students to communicate. And Flipgrid doesn't eliminate that terror of public speaking, but it does provide the student with an opportunity for unlimited, ungraded practice with their speaking. And they can see themselves and they can re-record as many times as they want to.
We are really diving into things like podcasts and blogs and Instagram and Twitter, and sometimes I have to take that lead because of the policies, but sometimes they can depending on their age and acceptability. So we've got kids who are creating their own podcasts about things that really matter to them, whether it's space or whether it's dissecting music. We have students who are interacting with authors on Twitter. We have one student who actually has the opportunity to send their her work back and forth, her writing back and forth, and get input from a published author that you can buy her book in Barnes & Noble.
We were also able to Skype with authors they were interested in, such as Trisha Brown, who wrote A Dog's Journey Home, and Peter Raimundo, who designed the artwork behind some of their favorite Disney movies, such as Mulan and Lilo and Stitch. They were able to ask their questions specifically to the expert, and through our blogs, are able to continue the learning after the session is over.
Some little things like using a Google form to ask students what they want to learn about and to go a little bit deeper in terms of content, what sorts of things they want to know more about, what things do they already know.
Our students create things like books or put video voices over videos who don't have voices or just create projects with a group. They do it through technology to prove their knowledge of the language, but also give them a way to perform that is not right in front of the teacher.
They also share their work through Seesaw with their parents. And at the beginning of the year, the parents asked me, I don't know how you have time to send their work to us throughout the day. And I said, I'm not doing it. Your child is doing it. They know how to send their work to you.
See, it doesn't matter if we are talking about our smallest learners, our oldest learners. They all are getting experiences in these classrooms where their voice is what fundamentally matters. And I'll tell you, one of the hardest things about getting ready for today and getting that video clip ready was literally there's probably another 30 different ideas I could have incorporated. Like, these ideas just keep pouring out of the videos that I shared with you today. So again, the lengthier versions will give you some more ideas if you really like that and you like that idea. What else are people doing? So the next question is, all right, we're at a point where we see the need. What advice would you have for somebody who's just starting with technology or trying to find new ways to use technology to advance the student voices and amplify them?
So about a year ago, I started skiing. Never done it before and tried it for the first time.
it was really scary. And that feeling that I got when I tried skiing for the first time, didn't know if I was going to make it to the end of the hill, that's the feeling I get when I try technology in my classroom. And it almost pushes you away. But speaking from a little bit of experience, trying things out and seeing how they go can just explode students' learning in your classroom with technology.
I kind of had to make a conscious choice to accept technology. Like I said, I teach Spanish, so I believe in communication, and for me, I believe in live communication. I like real people talking to each other. So I did have to accept that, yes, maybe using the VoiceThread app is different than having a student speak live in front of me, but different is okay with the technology. It's amped up the opportunities for them. I have way more chances to listen to my kids speaking than I did when I just did it live, because it takes a lot of class time, and this way they can record and I can listen to them and give them feedback.
Just to start small, there is a flood of technology around us with a constant need to update this and to try this new app, and that is overwhelming. And frankly, it could be a huge waste of time if you don't find what you're looking for. So to try to start using one tool or one app or one website that could fit with what you're trying to do.
The purpose of our work in my world geography classroom is to develop an understanding of world cultures. The results of this new knowledge is the development of a global perspective of cultures beyond yourself. When we've developed this understanding, then we make gains as a classroom. Students understanding that the world is becoming a global society is key to our collaboration and success.
To be hired in the school district of Waukesha, you have to be on camera and answer questions on film. And I know I freaked out the first time that I looked at myself in a QuickTime video as I was answering questions. And so I've had to take some risks in recording myself on Flipgrid assignments for students. And it's not perfect, and that's okay, but it provides students an opportunity to be heard equitably.
I like it because even though I struggle with technology and I know I have a lot of work ahead of me, it is also a way of them showing me how to do things, and it motivates me to learn something new, because I figure if I'm asking them to do that in my classroom, I should be in their shoes.
I just had to remember that it's okay to be a student myself. We ask our students to be able to take risks, think outside of the box, make mistakes, and just be able to fix them. And doing that with students is a great learning experience for them, but also for myself.
And so I have to let go, step back, and know that I don't know everything, and just say yes. Lean into it and say yes, and lean into it and know that I'm going to have far more questions than I have answers, and they're going to have far more questions than they have answers.
So just the moral of this little discussion is, don't be afraid to try something. I know change is a scary thing, but it really can be a big reward in your classroom.
So they're in your classrooms with the same tools that these folks have on the same networks. The same opportunities exist for them. I think you hear from every one of them the reality that using technology and change and trying new things is scary for all of us. Every one of them would tell you that they're not a technology expert, they're just willing to try it. So I really encourage you to think today about that question of student casualties. Think about one student in your classroom that we need to connect with, we need to hear their voice, and grab them and put them in your pocket today. And as you're going and learning from all of these incredible presenters, I want you to think about that student and how we're going to give them the opportunity to have their voice heard. So I want to say thank you to these wonderful teacher presenters and student presenters. An amazing job. I hope you were as inspired as I was listening to it. Make sure you make them feel like the rock stars they are today. Make sure you give them high fives and hugs and thank yous. Also, go out and thank all of the presenters who are sharing ideas with you today. And you guys have a wonderful, fun day here at the One Conference. It's about celebrating you. Thank you. Your next session.
Jesse is a friend. Yeah, I know he's been a good friend of mine. But lately something's changed. It ain't hard to define. Jesse's got himself a girl and I wanna make her mine. And she's watching him with those eyes. And she's loving with that body, I just know it. And he's holding her in his arms late at night. The charade, there doesn't seem to be a reason to change. You know, I feel so dirty when they start talking cute. I wanna tell her that I love her, but the point is probably moot. Cause she's watching him with those eyes, and she's loving him with that body, I just know it. And he's holding her in his arms late at night. She don't see.